and continue it on its aggressive path. More broadly, even as we've imposed and continue to impose massive costs on Russia for its aggression and actions in Ukraine, if we determine that there are areas that is in our interest to continue to pursue, that one faction or other may involve some engagement with Russia, we'll continue to pursue that. We're not going to let Russia dictate in any way what's in our interest and how to pursue.
Just a few days ago, the European Union proposed to donate a bear fighter jets to Ukraine to protect our sky, but as far as I know, for now, the deal has fallen apart. I know that you were informed all of this foreign minister whatever today discussing that this topic as well. Could one expect that after your travel to Europe, something could change and Ukraine would get access to the proposed jets?
Thank you. I can't go into detail on my conversations with Foreign Minister Kalayo. We talk about a lot of things, including the ongoing provision of security assistance to Ukraine. And that is something that I will be talking to European allies and partners about in a couple of days in Brussels. Again, I can tell you, I mentioned in response to Anna's question, that when it comes to vital defensive military equipment, that Ukraine needs. They're very actively coordinating its provision, and assistance is getting there. But we'll probably have more to say in the next couple of days. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. We've certainly seen in the past that one of Russia's methods of war is to be absolutely brutal in trying to cow the citizenry of a given country. And that includes, at the very least, indiscriminate targeting and potentially deliberate targeting as well. We're looking very closely at what's happening in Ukraine right now, including what's happening to civilians. We're taking account of it. We're documenting it, and we want to ensure, among other things, that there's accountability for it.
Secretary of State Anthony Blinken there with a briefing from the State Department. I was curious about the headline, Sandra, that he says that because of the devaluation of the ruble and sanctions that have been put on Russian banks, that Vladimir Putin's bonded war fund, which was valued at some $600 billion, has vanished. Which means he may not be able to at least financially sustain the attack in Ukraine.
And obviously, as they track where all of his assets are and could be all over the world, he's going to be traveling, as you just heard, Blinken, to Brussels tomorrow, meeting with NATO leaders to continue to coordinate the response to all of this. The door is still open to diplomacy, Blinken said. To the people of Russia, we know many of you don't want this war. This is Putin's war. An incredible description of what is happening to children on the ground there, John. He led off by talking about kids that are going through cancer treatments in basement shelters with nurses still tending to them.
Yeah, as we saw, babies are being born in their shelters as well. He's also going to travel to Poland, Moldova, which doesn't like what's going on because of the Russian forces that are stationed there in the Transnistria region, and then on to the Baltics, which he says are also under threat from Russia's expansion stems.
Good to be with you, John. Coverage continues here. Thanks for joining us. I'm Sandra Smith.
And I'm John Roberts, the story with Martha. Starts right now.
Thank you very much, John and Sandra. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Martha McCallum. Here's what's breaking right now on this huge story. We are about to get a live update from the Pentagon. We just heard from the Department of State. So in a moment, we're going to swing over and hear from John Kirby in terms of the military Pentagon involvement and NATO involvement in this war in Ukraine. And that is, we just keep seeing these incredible individual stories of sheer bravery and courage in Ukraine. Citizens cobbling together what they can to build roadblocks, to block Russian convoys, and even support, in some cases, of street signs being changed to confuse the incoming Russian troops. This man from a small village in northern Kyiv is Andriy Zhurchuk. He's 68 years old. Listen to him. And now, as you can see, in my old age, Kulatov, Ukraine officials claim that they were able to deter Russian forces after this act of defiance. Extraordinary. So we begin this hour in Kyiv with the latest from the front with foreign correspondent Trey Hayes. Trey, good evening, good afternoon to you. What is the latest from Kyiv today?
Martha, good afternoon. Tension remains high in Kyiv. People are starting to see this war on their doorsteps. Tonight we saw a rocket attack near the central train station. The difference between life and death for people in the Ukrainian capital is a matter of timing and chance. It was formed this morning at 10 a.m. as air raid sirens sounded across Kyiv. Now he rests next to his mother in the basement of a maternity hospital for families who are staying in the Ukrainian capital. The days ahead are expected to be bloody and violent. They're bracing for the worst.
Who can help us? Help us. Save us.
As new lives are brought into this world, the war is taking others out. Across town, 5 people were killed overnight in Russian missile strikes, bringing the total since the invasion began to more than 2,000, according to state emergency services. Overnight, a Russian missile slammed into this building next to a television tower in the capital of Kyiv. The air campaign against this city is getting heavier as ground forces get closer. With the threat from Russia present inside the city limits, the Ukrainian territorial defense remains on alert, while the bulk of Russian forces are staged outside of the city. Every car that passes must be considered suspect. They're coming from different sides. A lot of people came here before the war started. They rented places to live and were getting prepared. Street battles have already taken place in the Ukrainian capital. Today, soldiers are moving concrete barriers and sand into the roads. Anything they can do to slow that Russian advance.
Trey, thank you very much in Kyiv tonight. Helena Anchenko is a member of the Ukrainian parliament. She's currently in Kyiv as Russian forces push toward that capital city. Helena, thank you for being with us. I saw you yesterday speaking with Neil Cavuto. How is your situation today? I know that you were very concerned because you were hearing shelling very close by.
Well, the situation is not changing to better. The situation is actually worsening because Putin understands that he is not getting any victories to communicate to his people. That's the first thing. Second thing, they have great numbers of their soldiers. According to Ukrainian statistics, there are already about 6,000 Russian occupation troops, soldiers, that in this war with Ukraine. So he is getting mad and he starts using more and more dangerous weapons, like weapons of huge caliber, like so-called brass, tornadoes, the very dangerous weapon called Buratino, which can fight 24 missiles at a time. Putin starts bombing downtown of cities. Kharkiv was the Kharkiv downtown where 1 million people, over 1 million people live, was totally destroyed 2 days ago. Today, just an hour before, Russian occupation troops have hit main railway station in Kyiv, in the very downtown of city. And currently hundreds of thousands of people are focused, or they gather together at the railway stations to try to exit this hell, to go somewhere westerner. So we don't know how many civilian people were murdered because of this attacks that happened just one hour ago. But overall, the situation is not getting too bad. Of course, in a horrible situation, a horrible time. Thanks for Ukraine, but Ukrainian army stands still. We are fighting back, as you just saw from the previous videos. Not only men, but women, other people are coming to territory defense communities, taking arms to protect their cities, because actually we all are afraid, but we all are desperate, because we have nowhere to go. This is our country, this is our city. Cities, these are our families, and we have to protect them. We didn't invade anyone, we didn't even touch anyone. It's Russian occupation troops who came to Ukraine and started shelling our cities, started murdering civilian people. This is the biggest war that is happening in Europe since World War II. And this is really horrifying.
That you're on the front line of freedom for the rest of Europe at this moment. What's your message to NATO? What's your message to the American president?
Listen, we are in some time, but we are paying very, you know, the price we are paying is very expensive. Several minutes ago, you said that yesterday, and this is true, that yesterday, Russian militants attacked a TV station. But also, this is not the only TV station, it's a TV station next to the biggest Jewish cemetery in the world. And actually, it's a Jewish memorial where 3,000 of Jewish were murdered by German Nazis during the World War II. And now, actually, Russian Nazis or Russian fascists are actually meeting the same people for the second time. This is, you know, this is not funny, this is the World War II that we experience nowadays, except for the fact that it's only Ukraine fighting with Russia, and the rest of the world are watching it with, I don't know what, the popcorn, and, you know, praying for Ukraine, but prayers are not helping anymore.
We hear that you hear your voice, and we'll continue to cover it, and we'll have you back, and we pray that you're well, and that you'll get all the help that you need. Helena, thank you very much for speaking with us today. I have to go to the right now, where Press Secretary John Kirby is now giving reports on Putin's war against Ukraine. Let's listen in.
Tell you what we have done in terms of exercises and operations. Today, I want to talk a little bit about something that we are not going to do. And I want to explain why. Last night, directed a special alert of Russian nuclear forces. Now, in this time of heightened tensions, the United States and other members of the international community rightly saw this as a dangerous and irresponsible, and as I've said,